All right. Well, hello everyone out there in Zoom land and here in person. It's really good to be back. I can't tell you how much I've missed this particular lecture series, getting to hear from our colleagues here at LR. It's always a treat. Although maybe today's presentation might be more of a trick than a treat. I'm not entirely sure how this is going to go. Which is consistent with my experience of doing research in the last year. My name is Taylor Newton, by the way. I am an associate professor of psychology here at LR, and my clicker is not working, which is fun because it was about 20 minutes ago. So let's give that a try again. Oh, technology. Let's see. Nope, not gonna work. Okay. Oh, but neither is the space bar. All right, let's see. Aha, space bar will work now. Ah, clicker will work now. Yay, I'm good, thank you. Okay, so I had a little bit of a trick on me in the last year, which was that I had the sabbatical plan for last year, 2020-2021. And sabbaticals are often planned years in advance. And that was the case for me. I had been planning the sabbatical years in advance. What I was supposed to do was go to England. My whole family were gonna move to England and work with some of my very dear colleagues at the University of Birmingham there, who work in a lab that's very interested in the intersection of belief, whether it's in the form of scientific belief or religious belief, and society. We had these research projects planned. It was going to be awesome. This was the house that we were going to rent. The spire that you see in the background there, that is Trinity Church where Shakespeare is buried. So this was going to be our backyard. That did not work out as planned. Instead, what we did was we dug a garden. We homeschooled a first grader. We upped our beekeeping game. We fostered a cat. His name is Nino. And on the day that we finally called it in, on the day in about May or early June of 2020, when we realized going to England was not going to happen, we adopted said cat as our consolation prize. And I was left with a year of a question, what to do now? Because research couldn't be what I thought it was going to be, what I was planning for it to be. So I had the very good fortune of a conversation during the summer, right about the time we realized that it wasn't going to work out for us to move to England, to have a conversation with Paul Foster, who is in our communications department program here for the county, the Catawba County Communications Department. And he let me know about this project that they were taking part in that was dedicated to using behavioral science to improve public health outcomes as a collaborative partnership between Duke University, North Carolina School, and North Carolina State School of Design, a not-for-profit research institution called the Center for Advanced Hindsight, and then me, I got to join this team. And we worked with counties, five different counties from around the state on their public health communications, right? So some of the things, it's hard to see, but some of the things that we provided for them were guidelines for most effective communication. For example, how to use fear in messaging about the pandemic, but not overuse it. So very research-focused kind of recommendations. We did things like create social media campaigns that these counties pushed out and used. So one of them was about how to have a safe holiday, kind of meeting people where they were in 2020. So December 2020, we were kind of at the end of our ropes. We knew that people were going to get together. We knew that cases were skyrocketing at that time. Deaths were skyrocketing. So we created a campaign that helped people to know if you're going to do it, here's how to do it safely. So that meeting people where they are. We created other things like vaccine swag. Maybe some of y'all saw some of the buttons or stickers when you got your vaccine. Our group was a part of the design and the distribution of those kinds of materials. But the most exciting part for me was the research that we got to do as a part of this project. And I'm going to tell you about a few of the studies. There were many. There were about a dozen different research studies that we did over the course of the last year. I was the lead researcher for three of them, so I'm going to tell you about those. One of them took place on election day. And we were using online sampling up until that point, and it was really effective to get a lot of people very quickly. But we also had questions about how people who are online might be different than people who don't spend 20 of their 24 hours in front of a computer. So for this election day study, we realized that we were going to have access to a population that might really, or to a sample that might really reflect the population that we were interested in. So we used random cluster sampling, which meant we took all of the voting precincts and we selected 16 of them at random and had researchers go out to those polling locations. In this case, researchers were LR students, go out to those polling locations and invite people to answer some questions about the pandemic all throughout the county. We ended up with almost 200 participants who agreed to join us. Some of them participated online. So we had these yard signs out. So if people wanted to answer the questions online instead of answering them face-to-face, they could just scan that QR code and participate. We did have some people who declined, 62% declined, but this is actually really, really good for getting people to participate in research. So having as many people agree to participate as they did, that gave us pretty good confidence that we were representing our population of interest pretty well. We were going to get a really good idea of what people in our county were like at that time. So one of the questions that we were interested in following up on based on earlier research was, how are people perceiving the threat of the pandemic for themselves, for their loved ones, and for their community? And there's this very drastic effect that we found time and time again, which is that people did not see themselves, my thing's not gonna work. People didn't see themselves as being in very much danger from the pandemic, right? They were worried about other people. They were worried about their loved ones. They were worried about their community, but they weren't so much worried about themselves. What did this tell us? Scaring people with personal kind of threats, this wasn't going to influence people's behavior. This wasn't going to increase mask wearing. This wasn't going to increase social distancing. Instead, messages focused more on protecting those you love in your community were going to be more effective than the messages about protecting yourself. It's also one of the nice things about doing in-person research that you can observe people's behavior. And one of the behaviors that we observed when collecting data was wearing a mask, right? So whether people were wearing a mask or not, and whether they were wearing it properly, that is over their nose and down to the bottom of their chin. So we asked them about, we asked them a lot of questions, and we were able to see how the way that they answered those questions matched up to their behavior of wearing a mask as they were exiting polling locations. One of the things that was, really, really contentious at the time was, people who aren't wearing a mask, like they're monsters, right? They don't care about anyone. But that's in fact not the pattern of results that we found. So among people who weren't wearing a mask, these were the ones who didn't see it as a threat, right? So the reason that they weren't wearing a mask wasn't because they didn't care about other people. It's just they didn't perceive very much risk to their community. And that's why they weren't wearing a mask. Whereas people who were wearing a mask saw their community as at far greater damage, danger of damage from the pandemic. So this is another little bit of an insight. It's not that we have to convince people to be moral, to make moral choices. Instead, it's we need to convince people of the real and present danger. That's a kind of message that we needed to put forward. These are cut off a little bit, but another kind of a question that we were in is, how willing are you to do these behaviors for the sake of yourself versus the sake of other people? And far and away, people were much more willing to wear a mask for the sake of other people than for the sake of their own health. And the same thing for social distancing. People were far more likely to be willing to socially distance as recommended by the CDC for the sake of others, rather than for themselves, right? So this very altruistic motivation kept popping up again and again as a way of reaching people to improve public health outcomes. In November of 2020, election day, which is when the study was run, we didn't have vaccines yet, but we were thinking very, very carefully about how the rollout was going to play out. And we really wanted to know, how bad is this problem, right? How much of an issue is it? And so November 2020, about 3 months before vaccines were widely available to most of us, we saw a large percent of people who were either not at all or slightly likely to get it. In fact, only 50% at that time said they were very likely or extremely likely to get a vaccine that had been approved by the FDA. I checked our numbers yesterday here for Catawba County. We are currently at 51%. So these numbers have held up remarkably well. We were able to access those resistant people early and figure out what was the source of why wouldn't you get a vaccine? And so some patterns that emerged are ones that have been confirmed by other research groups. So young people at that time were far less likely to say that they would get it. And they're still one of the least vaccinated groups today. At the time, if you non-white, so this is combining just because of our sample size, we combined everyone who didn't identify as white. So this is a group that includes people who are Hispanic, people who are Asian, people who are Black. Non-white people were less likely to say that they would get the vaccine at that time. I'm happy to say this is a trend that has since reversed. Almost every group that would be combined in that non-white group has now exceeded vaccination groups for the compared to white people. And one of the main reasons for that is this next one. We knew very, very early on that political conservatives were going to be more resistant to vaccination. And in fact, this is still, so age and this, those are the top two predictors of who is not getting a vaccine even today. So we knew early on that this was a group that we were going to have a hard time with, and we were working from a very early point on how to reach people who fall into these categories to encourage them to become vaccinated. Another thing that we were really interested in at the time were myths and misunderstandings about the pandemic and the vaccine. So we took a bunch of common myths at the time. You can see some of the more common ones were spikes in cases are because of increased testing. Almost half of our participants believed that that was true, in part due to some of the reporting surrounding the testing. So like hospitals, people would go into hospitals and they would with their cameras and say, where are all the patients? You're saying you're overrun. And then someone comes out and says, well, we don't keep them in the lobby, right? But that was the kind of tone at the time of election day. So we measured endorsement of myths, and we found that these myths were very strongly, again, predicting behavior. So the people who believed these things about the pandemic were the ones who were not following CDC recommendations very closely. So the ones who weren't social distancing, the ones who weren't wearing masks, the ones who weren't even hand washing was related to belief of the these myths. People were washing their hands less if they believed these myths at a higher rate. We also found that belief in these myths was strongly related to being less likely to get the vaccine. So strong relationships that were helping us to unpack how can we address the problem that we are going to have in 3 months with rollout of the vaccine. We were also asking, what are some of the hangups that you have? So like, if you are thinking that you're not going to get a vaccine, what concerns do you have? So everything from, I don't think I need it. I don't think they're gonna work. It happened too fast. There was too much political interference with it. I have religious objections to the vaccine. We asked about a lot of different potential concerns people would have at that time, and we're able to identify the most common ones. So political interference, you can see more than half of our participants said, my concern about the vaccine is that there's been political interference in the development process. This was a cross-party concern. So been picking a little bit on political conservatives, but political liberals had that same concern at the time, as well as concerns about the process of the development of the vaccine. So that it would lead to a product that wasn't safe, that it happened too fast, that it could produce a product that was harmful. These were all big concerns at the time. And so before the vaccines, or right as the vaccines were rolled out, we had a video that we worked with a local animation company. Our partners at the NC State School of Design worked with a local animation company using these research insights to create a campaign that was rolled out on social media. And this particular one was viewed 12,000 times across the counties in the project. So let me show you.
Nervous, huh? No need. Before this vaccine reached you, it went through a rigorous process. The vaccine had a head start because there was so much research and worldwide collaboration aimed at finding solutions for COVID-19. It then went through the three phases all vaccines go through. In phases 1 and 2, it was given to several hundred volunteers to test for safety. And don't you worry, everything went well. So the vaccine moved on to phase 3, where it was given to several thousand people to see if it could protect us from COVID. The vaccine aced this test and was found to be very effective. Since we are in a public health emergency, the vaccine was approved for an emergency use authorization. And because it was being manufactured while being tested, it was ready to be delivered to the public immediately. Which brings us to today. You ready?
We customized those for each of the counties that we were working with, realizing that part of the big problem that people had at the time, so right as the vaccines were being released in December, we had this ready in December, was the process, right? So we set about to educate people about the process to alleviate some of their concerns. So the next study that I was the lead on in this collaboration was aimed at, did anyone happen to download the Slow COVID NC app? This is maybe a little bit hard to remember. A year ago, man, contact tracing was the thing, right? This was all anyone was talking about, was we have to be able to track people. And of course, it's still important, but since vaccinations have come about, we've really focused on other public health initiatives. But like, this was all we had for a really long time. And so the state of North Carolina developed an app for people to put on their phones. It was supposed to work with the near infrared technology. I don't know the technology of how it worked, but like you had this app on your phone and it measured, it picked up signals from other people's phones that were in your area. And if you were near someone who later reported I tested positive, then you would get a notification on your phone that you should also get tested. It was really nifty technology. There were plenty of privacy concerns about it. It was really a hard sell, even though it would have been really effective. In the end, it wasn't adopted at a high enough rate to truly be effective, but this was the great hope, right? So they were strongly advertising, help slow the spread was the tagline. The state was trying to get as many people to download this app as possible. This was their banner on their webpage. So this was the main advertisement that they were sending out. So we wondered if maybe tweaking this advertising could lead to a more persuasive campaign to get people to download this app on their phones. And so starting in October and for a month and a half, we collected data online. We measured almost 700 North Carolinians from 75% of the counties here in the state. And we were comparing this ad, the Slow COVID NC banner that the state designed, to some other designs that we thought might be more effective in convincing people. And so one of the things that we wanted to compare was whether using icons would be more or less effective than using illustrations that would tell a story. So let me show you the iconographic ads. The other thing that we were manipulating besides whether they were iconographic or illustrative, it was the message, right? So I told you this idea of altruistic protection of others over protection of self was a theme that was repeatedly coming up for us. So we had a protect yourself version of an icon that would promote this ad. We had a protect your loved ones as a motivation. We had protect your community. And then finally, all three, so combining, so if you can protect yourself, your loved ones, and your community all in the same thing by downloading and using this app. And then, oh, it's so much fun to work with designers, y'all. So like we academics, I don't know, we have great ideas, but it's often hard to like put them into action. Like this is not something that I could have done. And wait until you see the illustrative ads that they came up with. Look how cool that is, right? So it's a superhero kind of thing. She's like, she's using her phone and the light from the phone is combating the virus. So again, we had a protect yourself version, protect your loved ones with like the loved ones kind of behind her in this kind of superhero pose, protecting your community. And then just like with the iconographic ones, we had protect yourself, your loved ones, and your community. So all three. So we wondered how would these banners compare with the banner that the state designed. And in fact, we did find that the illustrative combined ad, so this is the one that's the bar that's highest on the scale of persuasiveness, so perceived persuasiveness, it was significantly more perceived as being significantly more persuasive than the state designed banner. So that's the one all the way to the left in orange there. So we're outperforming what the state was doing. We did communicate this. We were in conversations with NCDHHS at a certain point about this, and they were very interested. But by the time we got the results together, like the importance of it had started to wane because the vaccines were coming out. There was a shift in priorities, but it was fun and interesting to have conversations with them. It's also true that it wasn't just the persuasiveness, the perceived persuasiveness of the banner itself being shown. So people were randomly assigned to view one of these seven banners, right? So they saw just one of them. And the people who saw the illustrative ads and the community-based messages, they said that they were more willing to follow CDC recommendations, right? So this is an experimental effect, right? So we were able, by showing them these messages, we were able to get them to say, I'm more willing to wear a mask consistently. I'm more willing to socially distance when I need to. I'm more willing to wash my hands as the CDC is recommending compared to the state design banner. So there's spillover effect, right? It wasn't just about the in slow COVID NC thing. There's something about these stories that are being told with the illustrative ads. And there's something about appealing to a sense of an obligation to your community that was really moving people. And here's the fun part. It worked for willingness to get a vaccine too. So this study again was done before the vaccine rollout. We were getting people who were viewing, especially that illustrative community ad, we were getting people saying, I'm more willing to get the vaccine, right? When they were randomly assigned to view just that one ad, the community, the girl protecting her community with her phone, right? So there's something powerful about this kind of a message, which led to another ad that was pushed out to the five counties that we were working with. This one actually went beyond that too. This one, I believe, was 14,000 views, something like that, over the course of a couple of months. Let me show you this one. Oh, and I hadn't mentioned women. Women at this time were more likely to be hesitant about the vaccine than men were, at least in our part of the country. This was something that wasn't playing out in other studies, but it did in ours. And so we were aiming to both hit on that superhero note here and try to appeal to women. Had a little bit of a reaction to the woman with the vacuum cleaner. I did too. I'm with you. I lost that fight. Okay. All right. So the last study that I was involved in as a part of this project, some of the people in this room, you're going to see them in this next video. We were interested in seeing what kind of messengers for. So we know the messages now. We know it needs to be altruistic. We know that we need to kind of assume the best of people, like people who aren't doing these things, they're not monsters, right? So we need to kind of meet them where they are. So we have the content, but we don't know the right messengers necessarily. So we did a lot of studies actually looking at different messengers, like comparing Dr. Fauci to Kareem Abdul-Jabbar, like all of these different people as telling you about the vaccine. But what kind of kept coming to the front was the suspicion that the closer you could get to a person, the more local a messenger could be, the more powerful it might be. This is in the context of deep distrust of government at the federal level, especially, but even a distrust of local government to a certain degree. So in this study, we took people talking about why they were getting the vaccine. So we had an expert, Hank Green. I don't know if anyone watches Hank Green's the SciShow is a blog that he does. He's like a really popular science communicator, and he did this awesome clip on why I'm getting the vaccine. So that would be like a non-local expert compared to just, I'm not trying to persuade you about anything here, just some facts about the vaccine. And then compared to this condition, which was aimed at LR students. So LR students were the ones who were participating in this study, as well as some members of the local community being seen as seeing a message from very local persuaders, answering this question of why would you get a COVID vaccine?
There are numerous reasons I would get a COVID vaccine. One of them is obviously just to protect myself, but another very important one is to protect others. If it can help me not spread a disease to others, that would be great. I have a lot of loved ones who I haven't been able to see because they're in vulnerable populations, and if this helps me see them more often, more easily, I would be delighted.
I want to be able to stand up in front of my class every day without a mask on, and to be able to see my students' faces, for us to be able to meet in a normal, non-socially distanced way.
I'll take the COVID-19 vaccine simply because I have relied on these vaccines my whole life to protect me from bacterial and viral infections. Things such as tetanus and polio, meningitis, pneumonia, just to name a few. I trust the manufacturing process for these vaccines that has been in place for over 70 years. I also trust FDA's scrutiny of these processes to make sure that these vaccines are not only highly effective, but safe.
I would take the COVID vaccine in a heartbeat because it saves the lives of all the life-giving and life-saving people that work in our hospitals, classrooms, warehouses, and facilities all across the country.
I'm going to get a COVID-19 vaccine because I believe they're safe and effective. I've looked at the evidence and that's what I think.
Would I get a vaccine? Of course I would. I get a spam filter on my email. I have an airbag in my car. I'm wearing a jacket to protect me from the cold. We do lots of things to protect ourselves, so of course I'd get a vaccine for COVID.
I will be getting the vaccination because I trust the science that went into the process, and I also want to help protect the most vulnerable people in our society.
And I'm getting the vaccine because I know vaccines historically have been the most efficient and successful means to reduce the spread of infectious diseases.
So the reason I'm going to get a COVID-19 immunization when it comes out to the public is, one, I'd like to visit my mom. I haven't seen her in nearly a year. The other reason is I'd like to have my husband not have to go back to the hospital with COVID-19. It was really scary, and you know, if that's something I can do and my family can do to make sure that that doesn't happen again, all the better. I think it's really important for us all to consider doing this.
The bar for the COVID-19 vaccine has been set exceptionally high, and I am eager to participate in the global vaccine effort to end the pandemic. I'm very comfortable with this vaccine, and it's the right thing to do.
So that was back in January, again, before almost anyone was eligible to get the vaccine. So at that time, healthcare professionals were getting access to it, and in some cases, the elderly, but our students weren't eligible yet. So students were drawn at random from the population. So this was a simple random sample. Dean Katie helped me to get access to a list of all the email addresses of every student on campus, and then randomly selected students to participate in this study. And they were shown either this video that you just saw of local persuaders, the science expert that I just talked to you about, talking about why he was going to get the vaccine, or that informational control. And as you can see, for just about every dimension that we were interested in, liking it, how persuasive is it, are you willing to share this video on your own social media accounts, which was huge, right, as a way of expanding the reach, the local video was outperforming all of those. Every single one of these differences is statistically significant. If you can hit close to home with the messenger, you're going to be more effective. We wanted not just to stop at LR's campus for this. So Bill Richter and I, Professor Richter and I, we worked on a video in February to March, interviewing people from around our county to put together a very similar video that we then aired as a spot on television. So WHKY TV, the news station, as well as a radio spot, as well as YouTube ads. And this one picked up about 4,000 views around our county over the course of a couple of months. So let me show you this one.
vaccine because I not only want to protect myself, but protect the many individuals that I'm around.
It's just the thing to do, and I guess to maybe make sure I was safe.
I'm planning on getting a COVID-19 vaccine because I truly believe an extensive amount of research has been done on this topic, and I don't want to be around the older members of my family feeling that I might get them potentially sick.
For the safety of us all, I think we should support this.
Why I'm getting a vaccine? Because I think it's the thing to do to protect the community. We want to see our grandchildren. We want everyone to be comfortable and safe. And I think everyone should do this. I see no reason not to. It's the same as driving on the right side of the road.
The reason why I would like to get the COVID vaccine is because I've worked in the medical field, sometimes with older people, and I know they are more prone to catching the virus and possibly dying from it. So I would do it to protect the elderly community.
I plan to get a COVID vaccine to protect myself, my children, my grandmother, my family, and all those around me.
I decided to get the shot because I didn't want to give it to anyone if I have COVID, to keep from giving it to anyone, and then to protect myself so that I don't get it.
I plan on getting the vaccine in order to keep from getting the virus, and from the looks of things, we will have to have it to in order to travel and just be social around other people.
I think it's the right thing to do to protect our community and our country.
And so during that video, you probably noticed like we were intentionally filming in locations that would have been publicly like recognizable to people around. And we were also giving the locations of the people who were interviewing. In addition, because we wanted all people to feel like they were being seen with these videos, we had an eye toward diversity, including different languages being represented. So both Spanish and Hmong. And then we took that same video and we invite Eileen Trejo Ortiz. I don't know if anyone's had her as a student. She did the Spanish translation of this video that we also then put out there. And then we were able to work with a community partner named BVU, who did our Hmong translation of this video and also put this out there. On YouTube, there's a, so like we use them as ads, like we put money behind them for them to be viewed as ads. And for the Spanish version, especially the engagement rate was 43%, right? So 43% of people who started to watch this watched more than half of it, which is really, really high for that context. It's really hard to get people to continue. Maybe you've had the experience of YouTube. As soon as you can hit skip ad, you do. But a lot of people, when they started to watch this particular ad, didn't. It was reaching them at some level, especially the Spanish translation. We translated that idea again into print media as well. So for 3 months, once a week in the Focus newspaper and the Newton Observer Enterprise newspaper, we went out in the community, we took pictures of people in local settings, like trying to make it obviously recognizable, and asked them, why are you getting the vaccine? And so different pictures in each of those two publications for 3 months. So it was 22 different interviews from around the country, again, with different languages and translations being provided. With an eye toward diversity as much as possible. Why are you getting a COVID-19 vaccine? The idea behind this is local messengers and also making it normative to get the vaccine. Look, all of these people are choosing to get the vaccine. And the idea is maybe that'll make you stop and think too, right? So like, why wouldn't I? Like, I'm like these people. Why wouldn't I also do that? We even got Conrad the Crawdad as one of our interviewees for why he wanted to get the vaccine. It was because he wanted to get back to normal in the stadium. That was what he said. The last thing that I wanted to talk to y'all about today was other outreach. I'm gonna brag on our LR students here for a little bit. We have 14 students on campus who for the past 6 months have been serving in our community as ambassadors for the vaccine. They were funded by an organization that Christy Lorsap, she's the one here on the right, told me about and then partnered with me as a mentor for these students. So we served as co-mentors for the Interfaith Youth Corps Faith in the Vaccine Initiative. It was a $28,000 grant. So these 14 students were each given a $15,000 or $1,500 internship over the last 6 months to do vaccine-related outreach. And then the extra money that was left over from that, we treated as a budget to support these students' efforts for outreach. So I wanted to show you a little bit of what they've been up to. So here are some of our ambassadors at the farmers market one Saturday. They organized a clinic that was hosted at the Hickory Community Theater. And they were taking pictures of people writing their reason for why they would get the vaccine on those orange cards that you see behind you and then taping them all up around, having lots of conversations with people. That day, I think only 5 people ended up getting vaccinated, maybe because if you're using stereotypes that have a kernel of truth, a lot of the people who frequent farmers markets are probably not the people that we're trying to reach quite as much to get vaccinated. But yet it was an outreach effort that was really successful. One of the things that they were doing that day was distributing materials on how to talk to someone about the COVID vaccine. So you're on board, great. How do you convince your brother who's not? Here are another couple of our ambassadors, Chloe Vaughn and Cardo Grant, at a food truck festival in Greensboro this summer doing outreach. They have buttons and frisbees, and they were having conversations with people about the vaccine that day. Here are 2 of our ambassadors, Sarah Hilton and Asia Harold, doing door-to-door canvassing this summer. So they were working a vaccine clinic that was hosted by the Glendale Church of Christ. And then we're going about in the neighborhoods, knocking on doors and having conversations with people about the vaccine. That takes guts, by the way. I'm really proud of these students for putting themselves out there in this way. Here is Sarah Hilton again, having a conversation with someone during a clinic that we were helping with at Alpha here in Hickory. They're still, in fact, I think today, at the beginning of every month, they're hosting a clinic for our most vulnerable populations here in Hickory for both hepatitis A and COVID vaccination. This was a pretty special one to me. This was a vaccine clinic that was hosted at St. Aloysius Catholic Church here in town. And the Hispanic leadership of this church got very, very behind the idea of vaccinating. And this was, by numbers, our most successful event. So 135 people got vaccinated that day with our students providing assistance. This woman, she's receiving her vaccination card. She was so happy because she was going to get to travel to Mexico a couple of months later to visit her sons, who she hadn't seen in more than 5 years. So that was a pretty special moment. This is Rachel Hart, another one of our students, our LR students here, distributing side effect care packages at the Hickory Soup Kitchen. So the second shot often packs a little bit more of a wallop for having side effects. And if you're homeless or otherwise have a tougher life, you can't take off of work if you're sick, something like that, then having just a little Tylenol, some granola, some emergency, and then bottled water can make a difference in convincing you, hey, we care about you. You should still get the shot and it might suck, but we care about you and we want to take care of you. So that's what she was doing that day. Oh, here's a video from that day at the farmers market. So let me show you this one that they created and then put out there for our LR students on an Instagram account that they've been running. So pretty simple idea. We actually did another one of those, but this time instead of LR students with community members giving their reasons, and that one actually went viral a little bit on its own. So that one got up to 4,000 views on YouTube, and only some of those were a result of ad revenue. So people were very interested in that particular ad. Here's another thing that they've been doing. They've been making PSAs to address misconceptions about the pandemic. So here's Haley Pierce, one of our vaccine ambassadors, addressing a really common misconception for our LR students.
Hi, my name is Haley Pierce, and I am a recent graduate of Lenoir-Rhyne. And a really common question that has been asked with the COVID-19 vaccine is, does it leave a microchip in my arm? Is a microchip going to be implanted? And the answer to that is no. Vaccine ingredients are readily available to the public. Talk to your doctor, you can look online, but also the Mayo Clinic and the CDC has assured people that a microchip will not be implanted into their arm upon receiving their COVID-19 vaccine.
Why, it was jumpy just now. one of our ambassadors named Audie, he's been making these videos for us. He's been doing a really, really great job. So it's better quality than what you just saw. Another one of our ambassadors, Rachel Hart, has made yard signs that maybe you've seen around town, double-sided yard signs. Here are the two sides. She created these based off of research showing that among the unvaccinated, religious messages are the most likely to persuade people. So she looked at the research, she formed a plan of action for outreach, and then she saw it to completion. A really great example of a student project over the course of these internships. Another one of our ambassadors, a graduate student, Sarah Lurs, designed and hosted an art competition. So the idea is that the COVID vaccine is going to be approved. The Pfizer version of it anyway is probably going to be approved sometime in the next couple of months. And so starting the conversation, getting people more comfortable with the idea of kids being vaccinated and wearing a mask, right? So fighting COVID however you can was the idea. And here's a young artist who was entering into that competition. This is a really successful outreach because media outlets picked it up. So Focus Newspaper, Hickory Daily Record picked up the story, ran with it. So there's outreach at that level. And then also the kids who were entering the competition were really engaged with this idea. Here's the first place winner. For the youth division. Here's the first place winner for the senior division. We got amazing entries. Sarah did a really amazing job with this outreach. And then we were able to do outreach again using these images. So Sarah is now working again on yard signs using images from this art competition. Parents and the children who entered the competition were all really excited that maybe their artwork could have an impact in the community. And so that's what's coming next for this. And then in addition to that, the same ambassador, Sarah Lurs, has been working with a local artist to create designs that would encourage vaccination and mask wearing aimed again at kids, right? These are so every time I look at these, they're so fantastic, right? So we just got in our first test order of these designs on zipper pulls for backpacks, right? It's like the I voted sticker, right? So it's an example of what we call social proof in social psychology. If you see lots of people who are embracing this idea, it makes it easier for you to see yourself as the kind of person who would also embrace this idea. So this is the equivalent of an I voted sticker, but for kids' backpacks related to protective measures for the vaccine. Of course, we're not planning to roll out the vaccination ones aimed at kids until it actually is approved for kids. We're not going to jump the gun there. But it's still, it takes advanced planning to put these things into place, the foresight and the vision that goes into something like this. So, so very proud of our students. So one of the deep pleasures of the past year and a half has been the number of amazing people that I've gotten to work with, including my research collaborators at Duke, the Center for Advanced Hindsight in North Carolina State University. Like to consider them colleagues and friends now, people at public health who I've been able to partner with and work with on different initiatives, the students who volunteered their time as research assistants. These are all the students who helped out for that election day study. They got nothing out of this, right? Except a little bit of experience. They put themselves out. It was a long day. It was a 6 a.m. to an 8 p.m. day without much of a break. So these students really, worked it hard. They did amazing. And then collaborators here at LR were helpful for different things. So Robert Freeman, he works in our IT. It was either Christmas Eve or the day before Christmas Eve. I cannot remember, but I was having tech problems with a mailing list thing that had to go out. There was a really sharp deadline for getting some data collected. And he hopped on his computer and he helped me work through that when he was on holiday. So different people who supported in different ways, including people who said yes when they were invited to contribute to projects. And then of course, all of the vaccine ambassadors. Christy Lorsap has been an amazing co-mentor and partner in working with all of these fantastic students. Their projects are all winding down now. But it's been such a big part of the last 6 months. It's hard to imagine what it would have been like without these students putting themselves out there and doing all the work that they did. And so many community partners, I couldn't even begin to name them. These were a few that came to mind last night when I was reflecting on who to thank, but there are more than this. And I apologize if I've inadvertently left you off as a community partner. Yes, it is almost time. I'm so sorry I went over, but if there are any questions, if anyone can stay, I'm happy to answer or have conversation with anything you'd like to talk about.
Do you have a sense of how many people you might have persuaded to get vaccinated?
It's such a good question. A sense of how many people we might have persuaded. I don't know how to answer that. I could tell you how many people were vaccinated as a result of clinics that the ambassadors were associated with. That number is 300 plus, right? So it's a lot. Whether they would have decided to or not without that opportunity, that specific opportunity, it's hard to say. And it's also hard to say who we might have reached who we didn't have like a needle in hand, right? So I don't know. I wish I did. I like to think that the LR ambassadors, they had conversations with so many people. So I like to think that they reached a good number. I know I personally had a lot of conversations with people who started out as a no and who ended as a maybe or who ended as a yes. There are a few that stand out in my mind as especially rewarding. One of them happened just was it last weekend? We were in Charlotte at a Habitat for Humanity event. We had a hard no. And then we invited them into conversation. They kept coming back and chatting with us. And then by the end of the event, as we were packing up, she and her daughter both got vaccinated at that moment. It's amazing what happens.
I just want to say awesome work. I had two of the students, and they talked about it. I think they made it a point to always engage their peers, and Aileen is one of my students, and so I've heard a lot about it, and so I think it's pretty neat, and it's made a lot of impact on the students. It's awesome. She's one of my students.
Yeah. Yeah. Psychological, like a term called social people. So interesting how does that apply to those groups of people who reject vaccination from all of that work?
Yeah, it's so hard because if it weren't such a polarized issue, we would see this playing out in a very different kind of a way, right? Because it is polarized and it's associated with identity, that makes it even trickier. And I guess the question then becomes, there's more of an emphasis on the messenger, right? Is the messenger like me? Does the messenger agree with my politics? Is the messenger's identity similar to mine? If so, that's the kind of social approval that I want to get. And so strongly tailoring messages has been a theme throughout the pandemic. I was just reading an article last night from researchers at the Ad Council, and they were saying, like, every bone in my body is saying we need to have one cohesive message because that's generally what's most effective. But this past year and a half has been different, right? So not one cohesive message. So like, think Smokey the Bear, that was an Ad Council, one cohesive message, but instead we need to reach people where they are. And if where they are is very entrenched politically, well, then that's where they are, we need to go there. So like patriotism has been a really effective kind of a persuasive tool for people who are on the more conservative side, for example. You want the social approval of people who are like you.
Take off, don't worry about this furniture.
have a question. So there have been a lot of myths that have arisen since the vaccine came out, and you've noted some of the ones that the LR students were concerned with. Have you noticed if differing opinions from people's personal doctors have influenced whether or not, has that sort of arisen in the sense of myths nowadays? So doctors, personal doctor is pretty much the best messenger, very local and an expert and someone you already trust in a lot of contexts. So whatever you're hearing from your personal doctor is going to carry a lot of weight, whether that doctor is part of the misconception or the myth problem or not, like that's going to impact you more than just about anything else. Is that what you were asking? Yeah.
It's the second study where you're talking about the storytelling as moving from icons to more narrative based. Where did you place those banner ads to get that data?
So that was run as a study, right? So we hid those ads among other ads that we were asking them to evaluate. And so it wasn't a very naturalistic context. It's not like we created a fake website where presumably they could download the app directly. It wasn't a very natural setting for that study. It was just, here are some ads, view them, tell us what you think about them. And then the critical ad was one of the ones that they were evaluating. And then we asked them about their attitudes and behaviors after that.
Sure. So I was thinking about them being effective and then local actors being more persuasive. So I'm interested, how do you do something that's a local storytelling banner ad? Because I like the hero ad, it was really neat, right? So is there a way to, I don't know.
Such a good question, if you think of a way.
I don't know, we have to get the little artists to like stand by the work. I'm obsessed with Central Park, the show on Apple TV right now.
Yeah.
And she's an illustrator as well. So I was just thinking like somebody like her. Yeah. Anyway, thank you. That was really good.
Dr. Newton, I know we're coming up to the 11 o'clock hour, but we do have two questions in the chat that I will throw out for you. One is, can you speak to the student protest against required vaccines? And the other is, any recommendations about what we can do to get more folks in the area vaccinated?
The student protest, I was there with another vaccine ambassador, and I think the most important lesson from that day is related to what I was talking about before. It's like people who are choosing not to get vaccinated right now, I know it's hard to have empathy, but they're not monsters, right? It's really easy to paint them that way. But if you come to a conversation with someone who's protesting something like mask, whether they're mask mandates or vaccine mandates or all the turmoil that's happening around school board meetings right now, if you come to those conversations with a position of empathy and an assumption of good faith, you're probably going to have a more productive kind of a conversation. And the people who were there at that protest are no exception. So the other ambassador, Sarah Lurs, was the other ambassador who was there with me that day. We had excellent conversations with people who made points that were very relatable. So like we disagreed with them, and some of those points were based in misunderstandings or myths, but you can understand why people held those points and could respect at least the motivation, if not the point itself, right? So we respect people, but we don't have to respect people's positions, right? But if you come out at a place of respect for persons, then you're more likely to make progress. And then the other question was, how do we increase vaccination rates right now? Is that the second question, Dr. Fisher?
Yes.
It's a damn good question. 50%, 51% for our county right now is not great. And we're behind the rest of the state, and our state is behind most other states, and we're paying for it, and we will continue to pay for it over the coming months. I had someone in my family die this last week. So people people are paying for this, and the returns are diminishing for any kind of an outreach. I think the best thing that I can still say is, even though it's hard, even though it's hard to have empathy when you're paying for it, essentially, is to push yourself and to try to extend as much grace to others as you can. And it's when you assume the best of people, you're most likely to rise to that assumption. So I think maybe the day of campaigns having an effect, like what I talked about today, that was a year ago. That was what worked a year ago, but we're facing very different kinds of problems now. This is a ground game now. So it's a face-to-face, it's interpersonal. To the degree that we're going to move people, it's going to be at an interpersonal level. So that means that you, each of you, have an important role to play now in this pandemic, and seeing it too as harmless an end as possible at this point. In my opinion, that's where we are. So were there any other questions, Dr. Fisher? Take that as a no. Okay, so thank you all for coming. It was really a pleasure. Thank you out there in Zoom land. Stay safe.
Research
somewhere. Yes. Oh, that's great. And there are different, I think it's going to result in three papers.
Do a psychology journal.
Yes.
A journal. Yes.
Thank you so much for coming. I really appreciate it.
Yeah, that's very interesting. A good opportunity to see, yeah, you know, other people's research. That's wonderful.
Thank you, Pam.
If you need to participate in the event with the Hmong people, last time you mentioned, yeah, I'm willing to, yeah.
So B, who we were working with for that translation, she's the one Laura Dobson is bringing to campus when she gets the chance.
Oh.
So hopefully you'll get to meet her.